time, but I remember always leaving your practices like feeling so much more accomplished.
And everything that you've accomplished.
Yeah, I'm never too concerned about that, but it was the competition.
I remember that.
Who did that?
Yeah, I remember that.
So that was kind of, I don't want to say I was destined to, you know.
So going back to this real quick, Fort Wayne,
Indiana. The other part is a Wash Bay area, and that's where we have our hoop. And my dad always has trackers and everything.
But he was fast.
He was super fast.
Go to the gym early in. Oh, for sure.
Legends that people are like, who's this again?
He's in Ridgewood, New Jersey, so 20 miles outside of New York City. And I was the classic New Jersey gym rat. And I put characters like that in my book. But I was the kind of kid that was pale in the summertime because I was in the gym. Not all the time, but a lot of time I was pale. And that was kind of my home. It was, you know, the YMCA. I was there all the time. In fact, so my hometown would be like, let's say 30,000 people. But New Jersey is the most densely populated state in the country. So, you know, there's like where you live, there'll be a town, there'll be Corvallis, and there's a break till you get Missoula, right? Well, in New Jersey, there's 10 towns in between. It's just towns everywhere. And so in my little town, there's only about 30,000 people, but it was just crammed in. There was like a dozen gyms that I could go play between the high school, the two junior highs, the YMCA, the Catholic school, the elementary schools. And one of my buddies had the keys to the gym at the little Catholic school. Our coach would sometimes let us into the high school gym, or I'd get at the YMCA. So it was kind of like there was always a chance to play. Like you were never sitting around like, wow, I wish I had someone to play with and somewhere to go. I don't think that ever crossed my mind, because there was always somebody. You could play 2-on-2 in the backyard with my brothers, or you could go to a gym somewhere. You can get 3-on-3, a 4-on-4, outdoor court, indoor court. Right. So that was my upbringing. Again, like lifer East Coast guy. And I was lightly recruited out of high school. I didn't really blossom until my senior year. And so I was originally going to walk on at George Washington University. And then couple days after I graduated high school, interesting note, I graduated high school. It was either the day of or the day before Len Bias died. You remember that, right? When Len Bias in 1986 was drafted number 2 by the Boston Celtics. They had just won the NBA title. They were going to win so many more, and he died of an overdose. And, you know, he was at the University of Maryland. So when I went down to GW in D.C., it was all over the news. And so then that first summer, I played really well at the Kenner League, which is a summer league on the campus of Georgetown. And they had a lot of really good players. And then my college decided to go in and scholarship me.
Wow.
And then I was at GW for 5 years.
Wow. So going back a little bit, growing up in New Jersey, the family tree, basketball, what was this all about? Why basketball? Who are your influences? I mean, I want to know a little bit about that.
Sure. So I'm the youngest of 5 boys. So you could imagine, you know, it's a very competitive family, right? And we all played basketball. So my dad played basketball at Wheaton College outside of Chicago. In fact, his team, this would have been NAIA back then in the late 50s, his team made the Final Four at the NAIA level. And his team many years later was inducted into that school's Hall of Fame. So my dad always played. I had 2 uncles that played college at the Naval Academy, and I think it was at Lafayette. And then, let's see, my oldest brother played a little bit of basketball at Wheaton College. Then the next oldest brother went to Yale and played baseball and basketball for about a year or two.
Wow.
And then, you know, the academics were just too much, and then he just quit to focus on his academics. And then the next 2 went to college but didn't play basketball. But, you know, we all played in high school. And so we had a hoop in the backyard. We were constantly replacing nets. We had to eventually replace the backboard when I was in high school. And so, again, if I wasn't at the YMCA, I'm in the backyard shooting hoops, you know. And we had a big driveway to shovel.
Yeah.
And, like, the 2 feet right, you know, beneath the basketball hoop along the baseline would get shoveled immaculately, right? Like, you know, that was going to get done first before you got the rest of the driveway. Right. Yeah, so that was kind of – I don't want to say I was destined to, you know, play basketball in college, but clearly that influence of basketball and sports was in my life from as far back as I can remember.
And I love that. So again, you come through, you got this environment, it's direct influencing you and your mindset. You got this goal now, youngest of five boys. I have four brothers, and I'm directly in the middle. So I'm that one that nobody remembers. There's the other ones, that's the joke in the family. Like, I'll achieve, and they're like, oh, good job. Oh, yeah, Ryan's your name. Oh, yeah, I'm just kidding. Yeah, yeah. But, you know, it's one of those things where you're in that same environment. It sounds similar to mine. And you have a dad that understands the game. You have siblings that are competing at the high school, collegiate level. You're destined to fall in love with this. The kind of experiences that you had, East Coast kid, I grew up Montana through and through. What were some of these guys at this high school level when you were playing? Who were some of these guys, for one? And what kind of level and competition were you around constantly? Because I'm curious. This sounds fascinating.
Sure. It was a different world, and it was great if you loved basketball, right? Baseball was big, too, growing up in New Jersey. So I graduated high school in 86, so I'm a lot older than you. And so when I was playing high school and in college, but remember what was happening on the East Coast and really impacted all of college basketball in the country was the Big East. So the Big East started in, like, 1979. And ESPN 30 for 30 series, which are great documentaries, has got, to me, their best one is the Requiem for the Big East. It's incredible. And that, to me, that's like watching home movies. Yeah. So the Big East, you know, kind of came out of nowhere. And then, you know, one of my older brothers and I, when we were in high school, we used to joke that when the phone rang and it was for my brother, I'd say it's Jim Boeheim. And then when the phone rang for me, he'd say, it's Jim Boeheim. Jim Boeheim never called our family to recruit either one of us. But that was the game. We'd go play for Syracuse. And we all hated Georgetown. Everybody hated Georgetown. Loved Chris Mullen and the Redmen. We watched all those games on TV. My dad got tickets, I think, for two or three years in a row to the Big East semifinals. So, again, think about who you're watching. You're watching Pearl Washington. Ronnie Cicely, Patrick Ewing, the Villanova team that won the national championship with Ed Pinckney. We saw all of these guys. Back then when they went 4 years, right? You didn't do the one and done. So you had stories and great teams in college basketball that really, unfortunately, is missing today. Yeah. So where I grew up, it was kind of a suburban town. I mean, the basketball was good, but you know, there are better towns and cities nearby that have much better players than we had. But right before my senior year, I got to go to five-star. And again, nowadays, all the really good players with the internet and scouting, I mean, you're discovered by 9th, 10th grade, right, if you're good.
Right.
And back then, it was just different with no internet. And so getting to go to five-star was a big deal. You know, Howard Garfinkel, who passed away a few years ago, he ran five-star. Mm-hmm. Five-star was the camp to go to. Everybody went to a five-star camp. So I got to go. Ramil Robinson was kind of one of the big shots there, the guy that hit the free throws from Michigan. They went into the pros. And there were a number of other guys. I just can't remember. A lot of guys that went to the Big East.
Yeah.
And then in high school, I guarded a guy named Ala Abdelnaby, who went to Duke, who I think scored 20 against Seton Hall in a championship game, played a few years in the NBA. Then John Crotty, remember him? He played at Virginia, was John Stockton's backup for years and years, played some AAU ball against him. So it was good. There was some really good competition. And more so than that, like, you know, there were some really good players. Like, if you go to any city, if you grew up in Seattle or Dallas or LA, you know, you could say, well, I think it's these four or five guys that made the NBA, right? We could all do that. Right. And so can I. But the difference to me with New Jersey and probably parts of New York City, and I'd say probably parts of D.C., I really can't speak to other parts of the country, but, you know, every team in New Jersey had one or two kids. So in my book, it's Tony Giambalvo, right? You know, Italian kid.
Yeah.
Chip on a shoulder, 5'11", 6 foot tops. You know, he's probably on the football team, probably playing baseball in the spring. But they all knew the game of basketball because they lived it. They were always in a gym. And basketball may not have been their favorite sport, but they're in Jersey. And they would play, and they'd be tough. And they wouldn't take a charge. They'd stick their knee in your groin. You know, they wouldn't help you up on the floor. They'd mock you or talk trash. Unfortunately, I'm not a big fan of that, but that was just the game tough back ball. Then. Yeah, and there were a lot of kids that just – they were just tough Jersey kids that may not have had a lot of talent but just loved the play of the game. Yeah. That, to me, is what I remember.
Yeah. And, it, you know, it's similar with that kind of – the way you're explaining that part right there is Montana kids. I mean, there's you know, you get your – you know, your dozen kids that got that, you know, talent around here that grew up on a farm. You know, some of these guys I grew up with are, you know – played 12 years in the NFL. People are like, wow, no, this is a farm kid that just grew up ranching his whole life that, you know, just had that break and opportunity and took full advantage. But you would never think, coming from a town of 2,500 people, you'd have a kid in that little community playing 12 years in the NFL. Dwan Edwards, that's a shout out. I'm going to get him on one of these shows. He's a childhood friend of mine. But I could go on and on about this kind of stuff. And really, you know, Peter, if you think about it, it's those ones that just are tough, hard-nosed kids that make you, guys like you and myself, you know, kind of push to get to that next level. Just because they want a piece of us. They want us that have that ability or skill set. And they're like, you know what, we're going to come after you. And it actually prepared me for that next level, playing against these small town kids or kids from Montana or some of these environments you grew up in with these 5'11 guys. And, you know, just had nothing but heart. Nothing but heart and drive. They wanted to make it. And what they would give, I don't know, you know, your size, but some of these guys that were smaller and stuff like that, what they would give to have the size and the ability that I had or you had. And you know what I'm saying?
I do. And the beauty of the conversation we're having now is that, you know, when we talk about high school, yeah, you know, so I'm 6'5", and I played center in high school, and I was more like a 2'3" in college. But and at the high school level, you know, I was one of the better players in the league. But that doesn't mean much. But right. But the beauty of it is, like, you can look back now as you get older. When I got to college and at the Division I level, I was that 5'11 kid. Because I wasn't anywhere near as good as the other guys, right? I was that guy now. So the guys that would be on a podcast like you and I are doing who played in the NBA –
right.
They'd be looking back at it and they'll say, well, you know, yeah, there were these guys, you know, from Duquesne or St. Joe's or GW, and they weren't very good, but man, they played hard. They're talking about me. I'm that guy that they're talking about.
Right.
And so the beauty of playing where I did at Division I level. So again, I look back on it. I played in Atlantic 10. I just wasn't good enough to really excel at that level. I just wasn't. I probably should have gone to like a big sky school and played better. But at that level, one of the takeaways I had was that I got to see up close just how good these guys are. So I played against maybe a dozen guys, who guarded them, who played in the NBA. And most of them were marginal pros. There were a few guys that, you know, were an all-star for here or there. But they were so good. They were so much better than me. Right. Light years better than me. And they were marginal pros. And so – fortunately, I will never be an old fart. I already am one, but I'll never be like really old and say, well, I could have played in the NBA.
Yeah.
And the answer is, no, I couldn't. I wasn't good enough. I just wasn't, no matter how much I wanted to, because I got to see how good those guys were. And they're amazing. Amazing. Yeah.
You get that taste too, you know, you get that taste. And again, you know, you don't want to cut down any kid's dreams, but my own children, you know, I got my baby of the bunch, you know, he's all about getting to that NBA level. And I'm like, look, get through seventh grade season first and let's make this happen step by step. And we're not going to even talk NBA. We're going to talk about eighth grade season next. All right. Here's what you got to improve on. And number one, academics, you know, those things are so important as you go along. You know, what's your career after basketball? That's not the way I thought. I was always thinking NBA, 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 and I'm sure you heard my TED talk or whatever. You know, things happen. and you don't know which way you're going to turn. So that's kind of what I do with my own kind of kids I coach, any kind of mentoring. Let's go step by step, work on that next step. Because when you earn that opportunity to play at the next level, whether it be a college, D1, D2, whatever, you walk into those facilities and you know what I'm saying, where you're going, whoa, I was the man in high school. What is this? I've never seen a 6'10 guy glide down the floor, take off from free throw line and dunk it in a scrimmage. You're like, whoa. Yeah.
So you're talking about your son at that age. It reminds me of the story that I tell my kids. And that is, before I wanted to be the next Larry Bird. So that's the first line in my book, right? I always wanted to be the next Larry Bird. Yeah, and that's true. That was me. I wanted to be the next Larry Bird. Before I wanted to be the next Larry Bird, I wanted to be better than Matt McCooey. Well, who's Matt McCooey? So Matt McCooey in seventh grade was the best basketball player in my hometown. Matt McCooey could follow his shot, and he was so good. And I wanted to be better than Matt McCooey. By the time we got to high school, Matt McCooey wasn't even playing basketball anymore. And so you never know what is going to happen. And as a kid, you're always trying to measure yourself against the kid right next to you, right? Or across the town or whomever in sixth grade, seventh grade, eighth grade, whatever. It's hard to get into the mind of a kid that young to think long-term. But that's the story, the analogy I give, is that Matt McCooey was the stud in seventh grade. By the time high school rolled around, he wasn't even playing anymore. So you never know what's going to happen.
Exactly. And that's going to kind of roll into this next the next part of our conversation is, so you get to this D1 level, you're fulfilling your dream, you're seeing all these different levels of talent, you're seeing guys that are NBA bound. When did you start to feel that spiritual connection of what you're seeing in the gym and your mindset leading into, again, ladies and gentlemen, his book, The Blue Team. I'm just starting to get into this thing. And I'm telling you right now, it's already an eye-opening connection. But I'm going to have you speak on this a little bit. When did you start to really start feeling that drawing of a different perspective of what the game of basketball is teaching you? College level? Early 20s?
No, I would say that's a good question. I would say much earlier. So I grew up in a Christian home. You know, we would go to church every Sunday. And then in the summer times, I would get to go to camps in upstate New York. So in Jersey, you either go to the Jersey Shore or do you go to upstate New York for a week or two, which is, it's beautiful. It's gorgeous. It's more like Montana. And there was this place called Camp of the Woods. It's a family resort right on a lake. It's beautiful. And for 1 week of the summer, they had a basketball camp, and it was run by a guy named Norm Sanju. So Norm read my book. He was the first one to endorse it. Norm at the time was the general manager for the Dallas Mavericks. So Norm was kind of the consummate NBA insider. He had been the general manager for the Buffalo Braves, which, trivia question, the Buffalo Braves became which team? The San Diego Clippers. Became the Clippers. They're now the LA Clippers. So Norm was the general manager for the Buffalo Braves and then the Dallas Mavericks. And so he ran this camp, and it was, you know, a Christian basketball camp for kids. So you would scrimmage, you'd play games, you'd do your drills, you know, your defensive slides, you work on your shot, you do that all day long. And it combined the two worlds that I loved. And then at night, you'd have your Bible studies, and then somebody would speak. And Norm, again, knew everybody. So he would sometimes bring in some of his players for the Mavericks, Mark Aguirre, Roy Tarpley, Uwe Blob, all these guys.
Saw that.
Yeah. He was friends with Raymond Berry, who was a Hall of Fame wide receiver for the Colts. And these guys are Christian men as well. And John McClendon. So I don't know who's listening to your podcast, but if you're a hardcore basketball historian, John McClendon's in the Hall of Fame. And John McClendon was a famous coach. Somebody wrote a book about his team. They played a game against Duke right after World War II. But John McClendon coached at historically black colleges like in the 40s, 50s, and 60s. And taught at Camp of the Woods. And he was incredible.
Wow.
And so it was that Camp of the Woods basketball camp is like a 13-year-old, I don't really even remember which year it was, that I accepted the Lord as my Savior. And I write about this in my next book that I'm working on. So I always, had a connection with those two worlds. But honestly, Ryan, there was also a tug and a tension between those two. which I explore in my book, The Blue Team. And that tension is this. It'd be distilled into this one thought. When you wrap your identity in what you do versus who you are, then you have a problem. So I wrapped my identity into wanting to be the next Larry Bird, right? You probably wanted to be the next somebody else. And so how you felt about yourself was determined by how you practiced that day, how you played that night, right? By your next performance determined how you thought about yourself and who you are was, well, I'm a basketball player. And now, you know, many years later, with more wisdom and growth and maturity and sanctification, and you know, and the Lord, you know, knocking me on the head, getting my attention, yeah. I realized that, you know, who I am is a Christian. I'm a believer. That's who I am, and that's most important. What I do is I play basketball. Not anymore, but I did. And there's a distinction. This is not just semantics, but that's important. And that's a tug of war that I really struggled with throughout high school and through college. And in college, I spent two summers playing with Athletes in Action. Do you know who they are?
Oh, absolutely.
So Athletes in Action will send teams overseas. And then at halftime, you know, when the audience has got nothing else to do, you grab a microphone and an interpreter and you share the word of God. You share the Bible. Yeah. And so in 1988, we went to Brazil and played down there, loved it, had a great time. And then the next summer I went again, we went to Poland and Greece. And we went to Poland 3 months before the Berlin Wall fell down. They were still communist. Wow. We got off the plane and there were Polish soldiers with AK-47s at the end of the gangway, or gangplank, whatever you call it. And we played the Polish national team 4 times. We split. We went 2-2 against them. Yeah. So so I was always, you know, again, combining those two worlds. And it was really a mental and spiritual, a tug of war is probably the best way to put it. And it wasn't until I was done with my playing days when, you know, it takes a long time, and you know this, for the ex-athlete to realize it's over. You know, even in my dreams now, in my 50s, I'm still a star, right? You know, I'm still great in my dreams. But it was finally, you know, as I matured as a husband, as a father, that these lessons really sunk in. Mm-hmm. And they really didn't sink in fully to the way I wish they had during my playing days. I mean, I knew these things intellectually. But I still had an ego that needed to be chipped away at. And so that's kind of the fundamental story of Thomas Connor, the main character in the Blue Team.
Yes.
That is that, you know, he loved the game, wants to be the next Larry Bird, just like me. But basketball is what we do. Basketball, right. The ability to play is a gift. And who we are has got to be more important than what you do, whether you're the basketball player, baseball player, football player, the baker, the butcher, or the banker, right?
Right.
Who you are has to be more important and go deeper than that. And for me, I'm a Christian. That's my who I am.
That's beautiful, beautiful. And to keep going on that a little bit more, you have this understanding, this greater concept of who you are, and it's not by what you accomplished on the playing field. I see so often, you know, you talk about that guy living in the glory days. I, for a long time, used to be that guy living in the glory days until I had an experience when someone stepped up to me and says, "Coach, you don't even have to tell us anymore. We know who you are." You know, because I'm reminding them, "Hey, look, when I did this, you know, it worked. And I got X amount of points, and I did, you know, and I'm in their grill because I'm the man, and I'm the, you know, you got to get to my level." But when I had one of those players of mine step up and say, "I get it. We gotta do this, but I'm just coach," you know, and I had to take a step back and start reevaluating how I viewed myself and, okay, when to turn it off. I loved how you said that. When can we start living our life and not living our life as the has-been guy?
Yeah, it's like a proverb, really. You know, the has-been, the guy that still wears his Letterman jacket in his 40s, you know, from high school. So the way I would answer that is, you know, I used to be a sports broadcaster as well. So, you know, in college, I rubbed elbows and played against guys that made it to the NBA. It was the guy getting dunked on, not the guy doing the dunking. And then as a sports broadcaster for about 20 years, you know, I got to work with and interview Olympic athletes, pro athletes. And so it's a very humbling experience. And I say that in a very good way. Like, I have the luxury, I guess, at my age, I guess I still could, you know, try and spout off, but I have the luxury at my age of realizing how good those other guys are, because I wasn't that good. And I got to go up against them and have fun. I had a couple good games, but I know how good the pros were, and I just wasn't that good. And so thankfully that, you know, that humbling experience to me is a very good thing.
Absolutely.
I needed that. I even needed that during my broadcasting career. You know, the Reader's Digest version of my life is I went to college to be the next Larry Bird, and that didn't happen. And then I got into coaching. I spent 2 years coaching, and I was going to be the next John Wood, and that didn't happen. And then I got into sports broadcasting, and I was going to be the next Bob Costas, and that didn't happen. And so the story is, I was working for OLN, the Outdoor Life Network, and this was like my dream job. And I would have been early 30s at the time, and my career was doing quite well as a broadcaster. And I was covering World Cup skiing, alpine skiing. So Bodie Miller, Herman Meyer, if you know anything, Lindsey Vonn, covered Lindsey Vonn when she was a little teenager. And the president of OLN, they were having a, you know, kind of upper management meeting. And in all of the offices there at Stamford, Connecticut, which is the headquarters are, and in one of the upper corners, right, like back where these little deer heads are, they have a TV. And would have OLN on 24/7, and ESPN, and all the networks do the same thing at their offices. And somebody commented and said, boy, they're doing a great job with the World Cup ski covers this year. And meeting stops, they turn up the volume, and they watch. And the president of OLN says, well, who's doing the play-by-play? And somebody says, well, that's Peter Young. And he says, well, who's Peter Young? That's red flag number one. So then somebody says, well, he's one of our main play-by-play guys. And at that point, I'm on like every night on the network. And he says, well, his voice is flat. And so I remember hearing the story like a year before my contract came up, and I didn't get my contract renewed. And so this is, you know, now in my mid to late 30s, and I had to do a career change. And I remember thinking at the time, you know, I'm Peter Young. Somebody's going to hire me. Come on. And it took about 8 years for ESPN to call. And again, it was another curveball in life, but it was another humbling experience that I needed. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because as athletes, we think of humility or meekness as weakness, right? Like you've got to have that chip on your shoulder. You have to be kind of like Kobe Bryant. He's probably the one name that would come to mind. That would have the cockiness and arrogance to say, I am going to take the last shot. Okay, I get that. That's really good.
That's it. Yeah.
But I do believe that, you know, humility is an important feature. It is an important skill that you need to learn, even while you're playing, even while you are that high school or college athlete. Because, without having humility, you're a miserable teammate, really.
Yeah.
I think about John Wooden, right? I think about his pyramid of success and all the attributes that he talks about. And to be able to combine competitiveness, like wanting to kick that guy's butt, right? But at the same token, being humble enough to recognize how good he is and appreciate him and compete and know that it's just a game. You're going to give it your best. But all those attributes, I love Wooden's pyramid. I know I'm kind of going all over the map here now, but
you're good.
I talk about that in my book as well.
You do. And again, on the back part of, you know, your success and the things that you kind of sent to me, you know, through all that, you're touching on all your key points and why you developed this book. You're touching on things that in your life, what really created that avenue for you to go, look, okay, I got something to put down. I got something to write. And what's beautiful about you and your journey, Peter, is that you actually, you know, just a little bit that I'm diving into right now, and I'm going to finish this thing. I could already tell. It's a grabber. You can see just the little bit that I've read that you're just putting it out there in this real form that's going to connect to so many people that are not even athletes, that are not really into that world. But that message that I'm seeing with the biblical components, it's absolutely beautiful, man. It's beautiful.
Yeah, I think thank you.
You got a message that is going to really change some lives, and I'm going to promote it the best I can just to kind of get that word out, because a lot of people need to hear it. A lot of people need that kind of direction, if that makes sense.
It does. So, well, and you and I had direction through sports, right? Without sports, what would have happened in your life? Without sports, I know what happened in my life. I would have hung out with the wrong crowd and not as accomplished things that I got to. So the best piece of writing advice I was ever given is write what you know. Mm-hmm. And so and when you read a novel, oftentimes, you know, it's the author drawing from their own personal experiences. So The Blue Team, when I first started writing it, I was a senior. It was my last year at George Washington University. Our head coach was Mike Jarvis, who went on, you know, took GW to new heights. They were very good in the 90s. And then he went on to St. John's and almost made the Final Four there at St. John's. And so he was going to be the life of the anonymous Division I basketball player. The guy getting dunked on, not the guy doing dunking. That was me. And I thought, well, other than, you know, some of my buddies, you know, on the East Coast are going to get a kick out of these anecdotes, what kind of an impact is my book going to have? And so then I fictionalized it. And I would pick it up, put it down, pick it up, put it down, all throughout the 90s, you know, and not work on it very much. I would send it off to people to have them take a read at it. And, you know, I would get the proverbial don't quit your day job kind of responses, because it is, it's stuck. And so then one of my brilliant TV producers, this guy named Rick LaCivita, has worked on Monday Night Football, World Series, Olympics, you name it. The guy's brilliant. And he's a great storyteller. And I sent it to him in probably about 2005, let's say. And he said, he read it, and he said, you know, every great novel, every great story is about something more than just plot and character. So it's love, jealousy, revenge, patriotism, you name it. What is your book about? And I had no idea. I didn't have an answer for him. So then I put it down again. I put my book down. And as I grew and mature as a man, I finally knew what I wanted to say. I always knew I had good plot and good characters. They're great characters. But now I had a story of what I wanted to say. And that's, you know, again, the message that we've been discussing now, but your mind is your greatest enemy, right? We are our own worst enemy. And, you know, when the Lord saves us, he helps us conquer our mind. So that, as Wooden talked about, the peace of mind. So you've got the peace of mind to hit the game winning free throw. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that was the message behind The Blue Team. And think about biblically, in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Christ used parables. He told stories, right? He told stories to get his point across. And his stories dealt largely with agriculture. I think that's because that's what his audience understood, right? Mm-hmm. The parable of the sower and the seed. And you and I use sports. We use sports to communicate. I love using sports as a metaphor for life. I love using sports analogies because that's just how I communicate. And we do it all the time, right? If you had a great presentation, you hit a home run. You hit a walk-off home run, right? Mm-hmm. If something is going to last longer, like you have a long day at the office, well, we're headed into overtime. We always use sports verbiage in our daily life. I like to take it a step further, and I like to share life lessons because I've got 5 kids of my own now. And I use sports to do that. And that's the reason I wrote the book, right? Anybody can write a book. Well, why should I ask you, the reader or the listener here, to spend hours of your time reading my book? And so I had to come up with a good reason why. And so it's the message in The Blue Team that is the most important reason to read it. So again, just like when I was a kid, I went to that Christian basketball camp. I now combine the two worlds that are important to me, Christianity and basketball, and I made a book.
I love it.
John, you know, has forgotten more basketball than I'll ever know. And he wasn't a very good coach, but he knew the game inside and out. And so he was a young coach at GW, and everything we did was based on North Carolina, right? And Dean Smith, the Dean Smith way. So in practice, and our colors at GW are blue, white, and like gold, we would have reversible jerseys. Instead of, you know, doing a scrimmage shirts versus skins, you'd have reversible jerseys where one team would be white, the other team would be blue. And if you wore your white jersey out, so white with blue lettering, you know, your name, GW, and your number, whatever, you were a starter. You were on the white team. You were on the first team. You got playing time. The coaches spend time watching you, talking to you in practice, right? Everybody knew your name. And if you wore your blue side out with white lettering, you were on the blue team. You were on the second team. You were a scrub. You were on the bench. So you see where I'm going with this. Then it became your identity. Your identity was, I'm a blue teamer, or I'm on the white team. Nobody wanted to be a blue teamer. You wanted to be on the white team. But more importantly, you didn't want that to be your identity. And that's exactly what they did in North Carolina. They had the blue and the white team. And at GW, we had the blue and the white team as well. And so that's where the title for the book came from. And I just read Pat Conroy. So Pat Conroy is an author who wrote The Great Santini, Lords of Discipline. And he also wrote My Losing Season, which was his memoir. And so Pat Conroy actually played college basketball at the Citadel, Division I, back in the days in the 1960s when GW was in their conference. And it's a brilliant memoir. I highly recommend it, My Losing Season. And they had, I think, green and white. And so the second team of the scrubs at the Citadel were the green weenies. So I loved reading his book because it's the same idea. It became your identity, right? Like the guys on the bench, the downtrodden, the forgotten, the blue team or the green weenies. Right. And that, of course, is something, you know, like you can carry this over to the non-athlete, right? You know, well, the jocks or the cool kids or the druggies or whatever in high school and college. And now that we're adults, we realize how silly and shallow that is. But we all succumb to it or can easily succumb to it, having that be your identity, who you hang out with or what do you like.
Right.
And that, of course, is to be avoided, right? You know, we're more than that. We're more than just a blue teamer.
Yeah, man. And I think that is so beautiful. Oh, I cannot wait to finish this thing because how many of these young men and women and just people in general in life itself are part of this blue team. They don't realize the value that they actually have in blessing society in whatever they do. I love the message, man. And so again, that right there is the key piece and the reason why you became who you are today. You took how many years to finish this book? That's one question.
Yeah, so I worked on this off and on. So my senior year was 1990-91. And I don't mean to be like, you know, the Bob Uecker of like college basketball, because I mean, again, you know, Bob Uecker was, he was the Milwaukee Brewers play-by-play guy on the radio for like 40 years. I actually played Major League Baseball, but his shtick was, you know, he was really bad. And you know, that was his shtick for a long time.
Right.
I did have a couple good games, okay? I mean, I had 17 points against Stanford one night. So, I mean, I had a few good games. But otherwise, I did spend a lot of time on the bench. But so I started writing in 90-91. And again, I, you know, throughout the 90s, I didn't really do much. I always had the idea I wanted to write the book. And again, the danger for me, you might even be thinking to yourself, was, well, you wanted to be the next Larry Bird, then you wanted to be the next John Wooden, then you wanted to be the next Bob Costas. Are you now trying to be the next John Steinbeck or Ernest Hemingway or Pat Conroy? And thankfully, I'm mature enough now, learned it in my 40s, that no, I'm not. I'm trying to be the best Peter Young because there are no others. Larry Bird's taken. I'm taken. There won't be another one. We're all taken. Yeah. That's why God created you and created me. You're unique. And so you need to be the best you, right? Okay. So, and the idea with the book is that, you know, if you read it, you can learn this as a teenager rather than in your 40s like I did. So I didn't really start taking it seriously, the writing of the book, until I moved to Montana and I met a very good editor. She's fantastic. Didn't know anything about basketball, but she was a Christian lady and she's helped a number of authors. So, you know, I worked in earnest. Now, I had a full-time job and a life, so I couldn't devote too much time to it. But I first published it in 2016, and then I went through a lot in my personal life that I was able to kind of reread it with fresh eyes, and I made a few tweaks and changes to it, put a new cover on it in 2018.
Gotcha.
And so I took a long time to write it. I'm working on the sequel. And I've already got another book that I started about a year ago that I'm almost done. So I went from about 20 years down to 1 year. So I'm writing faster.
Good. But again, you didn't rush this thing. This is something that you put your heart and soul in. You knew that it was going to be, I want this thing to hit close to home with so many people on so many levels. It took you years. Yep. And to me, that you don't want to rush anything beautiful. If it's really going to be something from your heart and soul and your perspective with the spiritual components, I couldn't help but just say, wow, congratulations, man, for this coming to fruition and actually completing it all these years later. What was it like when that first print came out? What did you feel in your heart?
It was great. I self-published. So you send it to the publisher and they send you one proof back. And you get it in your hands. It's hard to describe the moment. It's like, as you would imagine, there's an intense amount of pride and joy. Because it's been such a long journey. The more poignant moments for me, more so than seeing it in my hand, like, again, yes, it was incredible, literally being able to hold my book in my hands. That was amazing. It's like holding your baby, right? In fact, I just messaged another author. He was coming out with a new book, Alexander Wolf, the great sports writer. And I said, congratulations on your new book. And it's not done yet. And he said, yeah, it'll be a few more months before I get to birth the baby. In other words, before the baby, the book comes out. Yeah. But that was a great line. But for me, some of the most poignant moments, like moments where I'm like, I've got to like step back from the computer or the phone or the email, whether there's an email or a letter, and, compose myself, because not a lot of people have read my book, but the feedback has been incredible. One of my neighbors read it and said, it made me want to be a better father. Mm. And when you read that you can have that kind of an impact, your words, your story can have that kind of an impact on another man. It's like, yeah, it'd be great to sell a million copies. Mm. But to have four or five people, literally, yes, have that kind of an impact, to say, it made me want to be a better man. It made me want to be a better Christian. I'm closer to the Lord because of your book. I couldn't put it down. I was crying through the last four or five chapters.
Wow.
That's an incredible feeling to have an impact.
Absolutely. I tell you what, that's beautiful, man. And you were blessed to produce this, man. It's crazy. Your calling. It's crazy. Think about your circle when you were a little kid, Peter, growing up in this environment, seeing all these different things in your life, to one day coming to, and you have all these different people looking up to you for that influence, for them finding that guidance through your production here. And it's the same thing with me. I go to these gymnasiums, I share my story. Everybody's going, wow, that's that guy from the documentary, Never Too Late. Or, wow, this guy's in a book. He's in, blah, blah, blah. He's got a Wikipedia. I'm part of a Wikipedia. But, to me, that doesn't matter. My whole story, when I have that one kid out of 500 kids come up to me crying, saying, you just saved my life, man. I was going to kill myself this weekend. That's what I'm talking about. You're not even an athlete. You wouldn't be on my team, but you're that kid over in the corner that went, wow, this guy's story is a little bit like mine. And he's got this message and this connection of, don't bottle it up. Come out and talk about it. You're not alone here. That's the most rewarding thing that I've ever experienced in anything I've ever experienced in basketball, anything in athletics, being able to be that vessel, and for you to have that, that's beautiful. Yeah. I love it.
I enjoy going around. So when I give talks, it's mostly to service organizations, Rotary, Lions, Kiwanis, stuff like that. And as part of my talk, I always love to bring up Jim Valvano. So Jim Valvano, the former head basketball coach for North Carolina State, they won the national championship on that Dunk at the Buzzer in 1983, and then went on to ESPN. So he gave that famous ESPY speech. It was the first ESPYs. It was 1993, March 3rd, my birthday. And I remember watching that, and the famous line he gives was, don't give up, don't ever give up. And I wrote that in black magic marker on a big piece of white paper and put it in my bedroom when I was trying to break in as a sports broadcaster, or I'm like, thinking, who's going to read my book? His words were very inspirational to me. And he also had another line, which I love. He said, every day you should do three things. Every day you should laugh, you should think, and you should have your emotions moved to tears. You should laugh, think, and cry every day. You do that every day and you have a full life. And so my coach, Mike Jarvis, at George Washington University on the back, he was the second guy to read my book and give it a plug. He says, "I laughed, I cried, and I cheered as the story behind the story unfolded." And so again, that's kind of like the idea behind my book is to be able to give you that kind of a day or week or month, whatever it is. My book will make you laugh and think and cry. That's a full day. You get a full day out of that. And sports, whether you're a player or a coach, a broadcaster, or an author or whatever, sports can have an impact, right? And for you and I, like, again, I'm much older, but, I mean, I don't remember – it's not the game-winning shot I made or the game-winning shot I missed or this turnover or that good pass. It's not so much those. Yeah, we remember those moments, but we remember the impact – a coach had on us. I remember the impact Norm Sanju had on me. I remember the impact a guy like Sharm Sherman, who was my African action coach, right? We remember our teammates.
Right.
And there's such an impact that we can have on the lives of kids. Right. When we were kids, we would look up at these players and coaches. They were larger than life, right?
Absolutely.
And we get that chance to have that positive impact on kids now.
Absolutely. I love that. I love that message right there. And to wrap this thing up, you know, I kind of want to close with one of those inspirational things that you kind of put into the back part of your success. And you talked a little bit more on, you know, you mentioned Wooden, you mentioned, you know, Corinthians 1, you mentioned all these different dynamics that correlate with the biblical in your personal and all these different goals. With closing on all this, what are some things that you can maybe direct someone watching this into fulfilling their spiritual growth, their calling and who they should be in life? What is something you can maybe encourage people to do outside of me promoting this book that would inspire someone?
Sure. Well, I guess the way to put it would be, if you want to be a good basketball player, should you get in the gym and shoot and work on your shot 7 days a week or for 1 hour Sunday morning? Right? Well, 7 days a week, right? Okay. So if you go to church for 1 hour on Sunday morning, fine. That's great. But, you know, you need to read your Bible every day. Just read it. Just get it out. And you're like, I don't know what to do. I don't know where to read. It's fine. Just start the New Testament, open up Matthew, and just keep reading. And read the Gospels over and over again. Read the New Testament, whatever it is. Just get to it every day. Just like you would get to your shot every day. Just like you would get to your putting every day. Or if you're a quarterback, whatever it is, you would get to it every day. That would be the most important thing. I mean, listen, I love my book. I think my book is influential, and it has a great message. But, of course, it's secondary to the most important book you should be reading each and every day. And that's the Bible.
That's beautiful. That's beautiful. I love it, man. And I love that you're a Christian man. And, you know, if it wasn't for God, I wouldn't be where I am today. And a lot of people don't know that. I don't share that a whole lot. But it's not because I'm shy or shameful. I just don't run into a lot of people and I have that opportunity. But, you know, I am a Christian and I've always been a Christian. I grew up in a Christian home. But I also grew up in a very native cultured background. With that, but it's always directed me. It saved my life. He has saved my life, Jesus Christ. So it's good to kind of get that connection too. I never knew that about you, and all the different people too. I think is really neat to hear Aguirre and all those guys, man, coming to these camps and stuff. I mean, that's really cool.
So I'll give you one more funny story, one more anecdote. So when I played at George Washington University, which is in Washington, D.C., and one of the most famous alums is Red Auerbach. So Red Auerbach was the great basketball coach for the Boston Celtics. And he actually played at GW back like in the 40s after World War II. And so all the years that he was coaching the Celtics and was their president and general manager, he had a house in D.C., right in the area. And he would go back and forth between Boston and D.C. And so, you know, every year he would come to a couple games and he would come to a practice or two. And remember, when I'm 18, you know, I'm going to be the next Larry Bird. And so I'm a freshman, and I'm going into the gym, headed downstairs towards the locker room to get ready for practice. And there is my head coach and Red Auerbach. And they're sitting on a bench in the hallway, and my jaw drops. It's Red Auerbach. He's the guy that drafted Larry Bird.
My God.
And my coach says, he says, Peter, this is Red Auerbach. And he says to Red, this is Peter Young, one of our freshmen. And so Red had obviously seen a couple practices and scrimmages. And Red doesn't say, you know, and he's got an unlit cigar, right? They just got done playing racquetball. He's still got the cigar. And he doesn't say, hi, how are you? Nice to meet you. He barely even looks at me. And he's got this gruff voice. And he says, Young, you can shoot, but you can't do nothing else. And that's the only conversation I ever had with Red Auerbach. Literally, never said another word
to me. Oh, my gosh.
He was right. Unfortunately, at the Division I level, he was right. So that was my brush with fame with Red Auerbach.
Man. I mean, that right there, I cannot believe that, my friend. That's phenomenal. You know, I got to Ken Rocklitz, the guy I played for, you know, at Northwest. They named the floor after him. I mean, he's a legend, Hall of Famer. Played for Gene Esplin in high school. He's a Montana legend. You know, these guys are old school. They're all friends with Bobby Knight kind of guys. But Red Auerbach, oh, my gosh. I mean, he's the kind of guy that can – oh, that's a phenomenal story. Thank you for sharing that. That is actually – wow. The cigar, too. Well, I really appreciate you coming on here today, man, and just kind of sharing with you know, the people watching this, you know, your story. The reason why you do what you do, and the message, the blue team. I'm just diving into this thing, and we'll get the link and everything up on this channel. And I really thank you for taking the time, man.
You bet. My pleasure. Happy to do it.